So nothing's in the way of me being. But in my life, the joy it brings.
Nothing quite like this. No questions all in. I've seen you come through so many times before. That's why I made up my mind. 'Cause in a world of change, you're the only thing that stays the same.
There's a time and season for everything, and I know the long wait can feel unreal. Wondering when you're gonna get what you think you deserve. If you think that's how it works, my friend, it don't. There are many things you have to learn to do before God can release what he has for you. While you're waiting on your blessings, work on yourself. Here are some things that you gotta learn. You gotta learn how to kneel and pray.
While you wait,
you gotta learn to not complain.
While you wait,
you gotta learn to ignore the mess.
While you wait,
you gotta learn how not to stress.
While you wait,
you gotta learn to watch your thoughts.
While you wait,
you need to learn to watch your mouth.
While you wait,
you gotta change what's in your heart.
While you wait,
so you can handle it. Please understand, God knows what you want, and he also knows what's in your heart. If he give it to you now, you may crash and burn. You gotta learn how to wait till it's your turn. Seek ye first the kingdom of God, and all the other stuff will be added in time. I'm only sharing with you what I know, because these are some lessons I had to learn. You gotta learn how to kneel and pray.
While you wait,
you gotta learn to not complain.
While you wait,
you gotta learn to ignore the mess.
While you wait,
you gotta learn how not to stress.
While you wait,
you gotta learn to watch your thoughts. You need to learn to watch your mouth.
While you wait,
you gotta change what's in your heart.
While you wait,
so you can handle.
comes from, cause faith without works is
dead.
You need to go to church so you can be
fed.
See, trials come to make you strong, but these are the lessons that will help you grow. I'm trying to share with you what I know.
Hang on in
there. Learn how to kneel and pray. You gotta learn to not complain. You gotta learn to ignore the mess. You gotta learn how not to stress. You gotta learn to watch your thoughts. You gotta learn to watch your mouth.
It belongs to me. Salvation belongs to me.
Good morning. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. The Lord is in his holy temple. My name is Rosetta Jackson, and I am excited to be in the house of the Lord today. I am also excited that you will hear a miraculous word from the Lord today. Praise his name, praise his name. So to those of you who are here in the sanctuary, and to those of you who are watching by YouTube, welcome, welcome, welcome. It is a pleasure to welcome you, to greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So on behalf of our pastors, Pastors Anthony and Margot Wallace, you are indeed, indeed welcome. So enjoy the service and pray for and with the pastor, the preacher, as he comes this morning. Let us pray. Father, I thank you for another day. I praise you for all the blessings you have treasured upon us, and teach us to share those blessings with others. We thank you for the preacher and the word that he will bring forth. May a soul be saved by the hearing of your word this morning. God, we give you all the honor, glory, praise, and we thank you in the mighty, precious name of Jesus. Amen. Amen.
Nation.
Uh-huh.
We will bless his name. Is that right?
Uh-huh. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Here we go. Here we go. Listen. Tell me who has the final say.
Jehovah has the final say.
Tell me who has the final say.
Jehovah has the final say.
And no matter what the doctor says,
Jehovah has the final say.
For he is worthy to be praised. Just touch yourself and say, I have no reason to fear. I saw three people do it. Come on, everybody. Say, I have
no reason to fear.
I have no reason.
I have no reason to fear.
He's brought me out.
I have no reason.
So what we gonna do, we just gonna dance wherever we are. 6 feet, 6 feet, 6 feet. 6 feet, 6 feet, 6 feet. Come on, everybody just get a praise on it. I grew up Pentecostal. So say, I have no reason. Here we go, clap our hands. It could be a scarf, it could be anything, but we're gonna wave something. And say you are good, say you are good. But y'all stay 6 feet apart, but we're gonna dance. Here we go. Has the Lord been good to you? Has he been good to you? Say, say, yeah. Here we go. Say, has he been good? Has he been good? Has he been faithful? Has he been merciful? Is he a great God? Everybody say, yeah. We're gonna praise him on the drums. Go ahead. Come on, let's clap our hands in. Come on, let's clap our hands in. Come on, let's stomp our feet in. Come on, let's lift our voice in. Come on, let's sing our voice in. Here we go. You are good. Say, say you are good and your mercy is forever. Hallelujah.
Financial Peace University is back. Classes start Saturday, January 30th. Classes are being held via Zoom from 10 a.m. to 12 p.m. Membership includes the 9-week course, in addition to apps for Financial Peace University, the app for the baby steps, and the budgeting tool Every Dollar. There are two ways to participate: self-driven on your own via the app, or in a group setting via Zoom. So I asked you to join us on this financial peace journey and participate in this life-changing plan. So for more information, please contact me. Cross Kids, join us the first and second Sunday of the month for a live stream just for you from 9 a.m. to 9:30 a.m. Join us as we continue to learn the Word of God in our own special way. Parents, to have your kids join the Cross Kids live stream, you just need to subscribe to the Crossroad Life YouTube channel.
Stay connected with all things Crossroad Life with our newly designed app. Events, sermons, and more right in the palm of your hand. Download for your mobile device can be found on Apple, Google, and Amazon. On your Apple or Android device app store, search Crossroad-Live. The Men's Huddle is back. The huddle will be held via Zoom beginning on Saturday, February 6th at 9 a.m. Men's Huddle will be the first Saturday of every month. For more information, please contact Elder Willie Hardman.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise God. Praise Him, praise Him. Come on, family, praise God. Clap your hands. Give a shout out to our Lord and Savior. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Woo! My God, my God. You know, this is the excitement about generosity, about giving. First of all, my name is Terry Coley, and I'm here to encourage you. I'm going to tell you, I am encouraged. I am totally encouraged, and I know you are. When I hear that word back, 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 back to the huddle, back to just being the best that we can be, operating in excellence. These things in this world are defeated, but God is never defeated. In the name of Jesus. So I'm here for generosity, and the first thing we have is we have five ways to give. And the five ways will be on the Jumbotron. You can see it on the screen. And if you have any questions about how to give, please feel free to contact our administrative office. Now, this morning, in the prayer, the first thing I heard was blessings. How many of you are blessed today? How many of you expect to be blessed tomorrow? How many of you expect to be blessed next year? How many of you expect to be blessed in the century? I'm telling you, I expect it. And boy, when you expect it, that means you're working towards it. That means it's coming your way. Never doubt. So the scripture today will be Deuteronomy 28, 1 through 8. Not the entire scripture. I'm just picking on my brother here. But 1 through 8. And I'm telling you, the word blessing, keep that in mind, blessing. I'm going to give a very short situation that took place. And I thought I was blessing someone, but it really blessed me. I was in Rettner's, and there was a family that came there, and it was the children, and I love children, and the kids was there. And after that, I saw them get up to the register, and I was behind them. And I saw that there was a little struggle going on in taking care of the business. And, you know, a man, we want to take care of our family. Am I right? Always. And a woman, you want to take care of the family. But when there's some difficulties, you always look for someone to be there. So when this took place, the Holy Spirit came to me and said, pay for their groceries. I said, what? You know, so, but, and then as things went on, the Holy Spirit chucked them again, pay for their groceries. So once the cashier finished ringing up all their food, I looked at them and followed what the Holy Spirit was telling me. And I said, excuse me, I'm going to pay for theirs. Y'all go ahead. So the father looked back and was like, excuse me? And with some sternness, go ahead, it's taken care of. And before I did that, though, I said, you know, God loves you. I planted that seed. God loves you. And so they went on, and they went to that car, and I paid for everything the way the Holy Spirit told me to. Do you know they waited in that parking lot until I came out?
and they came to me and said, what church do you go to? That blessing, that door was open. That seed was planted. So I could have been selfish and said, I want to be blessed. I want to be blessed. I want to be blessed. But it's about being blessed and being a blessing. You got to keep that in mind. You have to do that because it's not one way. It's the total picture of excellence. So now let me get to the scripture here because this scripture is wonderful. So listen to this now. Deuteronomy 28. If you listen diligently to the voice of the Lord, your God, being watchful to do all his commandments, which I command you this day, the Lord your God will set you high above all nations of the earth. Not some, not one, but all. So that means when you walk out that door, you're a blessing. And you have to intentionally make sure you're a blessing and not be selfish and say, I want to be blessed. Now, do we want to be blessed? Yes. Yes. But try being a blessing and see how much more blessings you will receive. Okay. Next, you say, and all these blessings shall come upon you and overtake you if you heed to the voice of the Lord your God. Blessed shall thou be in the city. Blessed shall thou be in the field. Blessed shall be the fruit of your body and the fruit of your ground and the fruit of your beast, the increase of your cattle and the youth of your flock. Wow, that's a full circle. That means everything around you is blessed. But what you have to do, you have to follow God's word. Give, tithe, be a blessing. Okay, blessed shall thou be when I come in, and blessed shall thou be when I go out. The Lord shall cause your enemies who rise up against you to be defeated before your face. Not my face, but your face. Not in darkness, but in the light where you can see it. Okay, they shall come out against you one way, but and flee before you seven ways. That means they're going to scatter. That's power. That's strength. And last but not least, the Lord shall command the blessings upon you in your storehouse, your bank, your refrigerator, your cupboard. Your cup will overflow. You got to remember that. I know you will. And in all that you undertake, and he will bless you in the land which the Lord your God gives you. Now tell me that ain't a blessing. All right, let me go ahead and pray. My God, my God, my God, my God. Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, we thank you for who you are. Lord, we thank you for blessing us. Lord, we thank you for letting us be a blessing. Father, we pray that the joy of the Lord continue to stay with us each and every day. Father, when we leave this place of blessings, when we leave this place of love, when we leave this place of care, we pray that everyone who sees us see the radiant of blessing upon them. Father, we pray that we're not going to selfishly hold on to those blessings. We pray that you allow us, that you will continue to bless us, that we just turn this world around. And Father, it starts at home. Father, we pray that we take care of home, we take care of our church, we take care of our families, we take care of our city. It goes on and on. God, we love you, we cherish you, we honor you, and financially, our cup will overflow in the name of Jesus. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. God bless everyone.
Y'all come on, give Jesus praise for that one. Yeah, that's it. And there's only one name with power to save, and his name is Jesus. Come on, let's lift it. There's only one name.
There is only one name.
There is only one name.
There is only one name.
With power to save.
With power to save.
With power to save.
With power to save.
Oh, there is only one.
With power to save,
yeah.
With power.
our voice and say, our God,
our God,
He's champion,
He's champion,
He
reigns
forevermore. Come on. Wherever you are, He's champion and He reigns. Wherever you are, whatever situation you're in.
Forevermore.
We're gonna lift that again as our hands and voices and hearts are lifted. Say,
hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Praise the Lord and welcome to the living room of God. Hallelujah. Are you excited? We're not excited because of the activity necessarily. We're excited because we have this knowledge that our God, He's champion, He's undefeated, and He reigns forevermore. Can all the born-again believers give Jesus a shout in the house? Amen. Glory to God. Praise the Lord. Thank you to everyone in their respective places, and thank you to those of you that are joining by way of the stream today, our YouTube channel. We are grateful to you, and we're grateful that during this time of challenge and pandemic, we are able to join together by way of technology, and you can see by our announcements there will be expanding in the next month or so that we'll have opportunities for connection and worship together in Jesus' name. Today also is the last day of our three-week fast, our 21-day fast. For those that started on the 4th, you have liberty, of course. Some started later. But it's been a wonderful time. It's been a beautiful time. I sense change and refreshing, and it's a great way to start the year. So I salute you in the name of Jesus on behalf of Lady Margot. We're excited about what God is doing, and we're pressing forward and pressing ahead. Hallelujah. Like there's no tomorrow, because there may not be. Not if Jesus comes today. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Before you have your seat, I just want to offer a brief prayer, and then I want to read a scripture as we tackle new subject matter today. Father, now we thank you for this particular grace that's on our lives. We come to celebrate together, and we know that there's no distance in spirit. We do pray for those who are personally impacted by COVID-19. And as we see everyone arguing and fussing and fighting about who should be doing what, our commitment is to you to pray, to be safe, to hold one another up in prayers, and not to disparage one another, not to become frustrated and disagreeable, but Lord, to really lift one another up. And so we pray for families that have lost loved ones, those empty seats around the table that were filled this time last year. God, we pray your grace upon them, and we pray for them with renewed vigor, that you would restore unto them the joy that can only come from Jesus Christ. We pray for those that are lost, that they would be found as they have been found in Jesus Christ, and that they would receive you as Savior and Lord, Prince and King. Hallelujah. The old song says, King of my life, I crown thee now. Thine shall the glory be. We'll never forget what you've done for us. And so give grace as we enter into this time of study. We give you praise in advance in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Just before you have your seats, I want to turn your attention to 1 John 5. And we have a habit of posting scriptures. This one isn't on the Jumbotron today, but if you have your Bible or your device, it's not just good to be able to reference that. I still carry an old Bible, read out of an old Bible, because there's something in the book, there's something between the pages, and you and I should be, we should be of such persuasion that we just won't use technology. Maybe that's good for quick reference and like that. But again, if we read the Bible, then God's going to read us through the Bible, and God will locate us, and we'll be the better for it. But this is the Message translation, 1 John 5, verses 14 and 15. Now pay close attention, because this is our launch point today for our study. The Message says in this section, this is the reality, not the illusion. Verse 13. My purpose in writing is simply this, that you who believe on God's Son will know beyond a shadow of a doubt that you have eternal life. The reality and not the illusion, not the illusion of eternal life, but you have eternal life now. And how bold and free we then become in his presence, freely asking according to his will, sure that he's listening. And if we're confident that he's listening, we know that what we have asked is as good as ours. Huh. That's worth reading again. The apostle says, my purpose, my intention in writing this to you who believe, that you who believe in God's Son will know, say no, not hope, not think, might know beyond a shadow of a doubt that you have eternal life, the reality and not the illusion, and how bold and free we then become in his presence. And this is where we're going to be today. Whenever we're in his presence, which is always, we can be bold and we can be free. Freely asking according to his will, positive that he is listening. And if we're confident, positive that he is listening, we also know that what we've asked for is as good as ours. Praise be to God. So you may have your seat in the presence of our life-changing King. So today we're gonna move from this subject, faith in God and confidence in prayer. Faith in God and confidence in prayer. If you're like me, I don't believe that we are isolated in what God shares with us as a unified body of believers, but God has probably dealt with you sometime this year, and certainly sometime during this fast time, about your prayer life. Amen? It has been said that if we don't have a prayer life, we have no life at all. I believe it was Martin Luther that said something like, to be a Christian without a prayer life would be like trying to live without breathing. And it is true. Prayer is that thing that connects us to God. It's the lifeline. As a fish needs water, so it is that a Christian needs to pray. And I've been prompted, I've been encouraged, I've been provoked, I've been ignited, and now I'm excited about another dimension in the development of my own prayer life. How about you? So faith in God is one thing, but confidence in prayer is another. Let me illustrate. Everybody believes in God. Christians believe in God, but probably the one thing that is lacking in a lot of Christians' life, if not always, but from time to time, is a lack of prayer and a lack of effective prayer. And part of the reason is that we don't see our prayers answered sometimes, or sometimes they're answered in a way that we didn't count on. Or they're answered not in the way that we depicted our prayer and thought that the prayer should be answered. And really what that does is mess with our confidence. We trust in God, and so we come up with phrases like, God is able, and he certainly is, but we don't know if he will or not. Certainly God is able to do it. He's able. But will he? The scripture we just read says that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us, and if we ask, and this is the confidence that we have, that if we ask according to his will, that we know also that we have the petitions or the request that we desired of him. That's a powerful statement. That's a bold statement. So moving forward, I want us to be a church, a collection, a congregation of intensified prayer warriors. Now, prayer can be a duty or prayer can be a delight. It depends on you. I'll tell this quick story. Years ago, I was in Coppers Cove, Texas, and we were seeking out a church to go to. We found that church, Christian House of Prayer. We're still partners and members there. We still contribute. We still receive from the leadership there, Pastor Valerie Holcomb. That was an answer to prayer. I was here in Delaware and working at the chicken factory. And Margo was working at a chicken factory around on the other side of town or in the next town over in Milford. I was in Felton and frustrated You know how it is. Because you know inside, I'm not a prideful person, but you know inside that I'm better than my circumstance. I believe God, and I give my life to the Lord at 19 years old, so I said, God, I know that you have what's best for me, and sometimes I can get out of step with God. And just to get us in the water, get our toes in the water today, maybe most of this will be the narrative of and that'll help us move into this from week to week. So I began to pray. I began to pray in my frustration. I had a pastor friend, hey, give me a key to your church. I'm going to stop by on the way home from all the chickens and see, can I offer up a prayer to God? Now, what I did is I offered a prayer with plenty of emotion. I offered a prayer with passionate, crying, begging, pleading. But I didn't offer up a prayer really according to God's word. Now, God has pity on us. God can read the messages that are encoded in our tears. And so God shows grace and mercy. But you and I, if we've been believers any length of time, then you and I have to learn how to become effective prayer practitioners, because everything happens through prayer. Nothing in the earth happens without prayers, right? Prayers is my communication to God and God's communication with me. And so we want to get very, very proficient in our prayer life. And given the state of the world and given the state maybe that's going on in your house, all the unrest that comes, all the unplanned challenges, all the dilemmas, all the financial issues, the kids, the grandkids, the stepkids, baby kids, everybody kids, you can get frazzled. No doubt during this pandemic, there's been times when people have gotten what they call it, the cabin fever, where you just stuck inside and when is this going to end, right? Well, it's going to end when God says it's over, first and foremost. No matter what the scientists do, we'll do what we're supposed to do. But in this, God says, I want to know, can I get your attention? I want to know, can I talk to you about what I need from you? And sometimes the scripture indicates that sometimes we don't receive from God because we don't ask from God, ask God. In other words, we don't put a petition up there, and when we do, it's all messed up. So God is going to teach us, God is going to show us, God is going to demonstrate to us during this time how to grow up in our prayer time, how to grow up in our prayer life, and so it won't be drudgery. Hallelujah. How many of you can truthfully tell, it's like, oh, Lord, you know, I done prayed and... See, no one wants to confess. But it has been said by some pastors that the prayer meeting is the smallest meeting that the church ever has. And some people excuse it by saying, well, I can pray at home. Yeah, you can pray at home, but you don't. Not like you're supposed to. And what we do is appeal to God's grace, but we don't appeal to God's power because we don't know about it. Listen, God wants to answer every prayer that you pray with clarity and affirmation. Hallelujah. Sometimes we'll pray and it seems like God says nothing. That doesn't mean we stop praying. We'll see it today as we get into these scriptures. So years ago, I was in Texas, and just to make the story a little shorter, I went to the pastor's house. This was back before he was Bishop Holcomb. And, you know, I showed up unannounced, and he was gracious. I just knocked on the door. He answers the door. Oh, hey, Wallace, how you doing? It's at nighttime. But I just felt the press to go. So that's an occupational hazard if you're a pastor. Folks show up sometimes, and you have to be nice. You don't have to be, but I choose to be because you know there's a reward coming on the other side of that. But he probably gauged me real quick. He says, oh, Wallace, how are you doing? I said, Pastor, I'm so sorry. I don't even know why I'm here. I just felt like I needed to come over. He says, great. He was in kind of like a bathrobe and, you know, in his relaxing lounge gear. And he had some papers in his hand. And he had his robe, you know, silk robe. He says, come on in. He says, come in. You can help me pray. I said, okay. So we goes down this hallway, and I remember turning to the right and going into what was his game room. I haven't told this in a while, maybe new, but it's worth a review. I went to his game room, and as I rounded the corner to the right, all I saw was 8.5 by 11 pieces of paper, typewritten, all over the room. He had a pool table, regulation pool table, all over the pool table, all on the chairs, all on the countertops, everywhere where there was a surface, including the floor. There were 8.5 by 11 pieces of paper, typewritten, plus those that were in his hand. And I came to find out that he was in there doing business with God, and all those papers were filled with prayers that he had written out, and then typed out, plus the ones that he was holding in his hands. And at that moment, I said, man, I am not even saved. And I mean, he went to town, and I was just kind of watching him for a second, but he was teaching us how to pray, but he was very diligent about his prayer. I've heard him say at times, he says, listen, I got to go in my prayer time. He said, I'll come back. I'll be back in about 6 hours. Now, that's not to blow him up. It's just where he developed in his prayer life that he recognized, I can't live without prayer. You can put on the music, you can worship God, you can study the scriptures, but nothing takes the place of prayer. Oh my God, even in the spirit right now, because we are talking about prayer, demons are getting agitated. I can sense a clarity in the Holy Spirit because whatever else you do, don't pray. We don't want to get them praying. We don't want to get them connecting with God in intimacy. And so what it is we're going to delve into the excitement, the life that come out of prayer. So this is faith in God, confidence in prayer. Why did you couch it that way? Because we can have faith in God without having confidence in prayer. So that's why we'll pray sometimes a weak prayer and understand, I'm not castigating anybody. We all been there, may go there again. You know how it is when you can get overwhelmed. David said, when my heart is overwhelmed, then lead me to the rock that's higher than I. It's just life's vicissitudes, and hopefully we'll be able to give one another a jump start as we go through this prayer lesson. Ephesians 2, verses 17 and 18, this is the CEV, Contemporary English. Christ came and preached peace to you Gentiles who were far off from God, and peace to us Jews. He's making a difference here because he's going to show us what God has done between two different ethnic groups, two different spiritual groups. He says, peace to us Gentiles, peace to us Jews who were near to God, and because of Christ, say because of Christ, all of us can come to the Father by the same Spirit. So he's showing us that you and I as believers have access directly to God through Jesus Christ. I know you knew that, but I want your spirit to know. You know it in your head, but you need to know it in your spirit when it comes time to pray. Now, Hebrews 4 is interesting. Let's read verse 16 first. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in the time of need. That's interesting. The writer says, let us therefore, or we can come boldly. Another word would be confidently, with great confidence. Confidence means it's the quality of state of being absolutely certain of your conviction. He says, we can come boldly, confidently to the throne of grace that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in the time of need, whatever help you need. Why is that so? Look at verse 14. Seeing then that we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast to our confession. Let us hold fast to our conviction. Let us hold fast to what we said the gospel convinced us of. Are you born again? Are you saved? Listen, there are no second-class Christians. Are you hearing me? You're just as saved as you're going to be, and you're just as saved as anybody else that's saved. There's no competition in Christianity. All of us have the same access to the same God by the same Spirit. Hallelujah. God is as willing to hear my prayer as he's willing to hear your prayer. He's as willing to hear your prayer and prayers as he is to hear my prayers. I wasn't going to say this, but I want to go quickly to Revelation. I don't have chapter and verse, but there's a vision that John saw when he was on the island of Patmos being tortured and in prison. And he said, I saw this one picture, and it was the vials. There was these vials before God, or containers, or vases, if you will. And it says they were filled with the odor of the prayers of the saints. Hallelujah. So there's a place that your prayers are deposited when you launch them heavenward. It doesn't even say how many vials they were. They were filled with the prayers of the saints from all the ages. That's how powerful prayer is. God has a special place of reservation for the prayers that saints have prayed through the ages. He says, we have a great high priest. He says, let us hold to the confession of our faith. Verse 15, for we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weakness, right? Now, let's make this clear. Even though God sympathizes with your weakness or your frailty, that's not what gets him moving. All right? But was in all points tempted as are we, yet without sin. Because of all of that, we can come boldly to Father God. I want to reiterate again, we can pray emotionally and passionately, but part of this teaching is we want to pray intelligently. God's not coming because of the volume. God's not coming because you call his name 100 times or there's some incantation that you're used to. God's going to come because of several factors that we're going to discuss in a minute. Five things that you should know as you pray. Now, I'm assuming that most, if not all of us here in this gathering today are born again. There may be some we're not sure. We have an opportunity to pray together to make sure the devil is cast out, Jesus is in our hearts, and that you and I are on equal footing as believers, right? Let me use this example. You can act childlike, right? You can pray like a child. Now I lay me down to sleep, right? I'm not knocking it. I'm just saying those are elementary, rudimentary prayers that we learn to pray. Father, thank you for this food. God is great. God. So we learn how to pray those prayers. But they're prayers like a child. Now, we should pray with a childlike attitude, but we should not pray childish prayers. Okay? More to follow. So here's five things that I want you just to take for granted. Just trust me that these things are true. We can prove it by the scripture. Because some people are saved, they have enough faith to believe that God saved them through the shed blood of Jesus Christ on the cross, but we're not developed enough to believe that we can pray intelligently to God and more often than not have our prayers answered in the affirmative. Are you hearing me? Have you ever prayed for something and it didn't happen? Right? Have you ever prayed for something or two or three things in a row and it didn't happen? And that can mess with your confidence unless you know the heart of God. All right, so let's begin. Five things you need to know. Number one, God is real. What about people that don't believe in God? The only people that need to believe in God is you. The Bible says in Psalms, the fool has said in his heart, there is no God. That's not my words, that's God. So I don't want to be a foolish person, so by his own record, wisdom begins through the fear and the knowledge of God. So God is real. How many of you found out God to be real in a tangible way? In other words, if they put a gun to your head, you wouldn't take back your salvation. You wouldn't take that back, right? There are some people that had a gun to their head in this audience, right? Think about it now. If someone put a gun to your head, are you assured of your salvation that you wouldn't renounce your faith in Christ? At least we think so, right? We don't have any reason not to think so. So for us, God has proven real. Some of us have had tangible experiences in our discipleship with God to know and show and prove that God is real according to the scripture. So God is real. He's not a fantasy. He's not a fallacy. He's not a fairy tale. God is faithful and God is real. We learn all the time in the scriptures how valid they are, how they line up with one another, and how there are no contradictions. Really, there's some difficult scriptures, but there are really no contradictions. But to the casual observer that's taken Bible as a literary class at college, it's not going to make any sense to you. The way you begin to understand the scripture is come to Christ. Come to Christ. All ye that labor and are heavy laden, come to Christ, and he will give you his rest through eternal life, fill you with the Spirit, and he is the great teacher, the demystifier of all that's in the Word. God is real. Say it with me, God is real. Second thing, God is present. If the scripture is true, one of the things theologically we say is God is omnipresent. Omni, that means everywhere, in every direction, God is present, right? That means God is here. God is here right now. Well, I can't see God, it's not, well, you've been breathing since you came in the room and you can't see the air you're breathing, but you know it's here. And if the oxygen can give you animated biological life, then God is here because he's the one that produced the air that you're breathing. And listen, so he is even more real than the air you're breathing. So God is present. God is here right now. And there's never a time when God won't be here. Listen, God is here when you do good. God is here when you do bad. God is here when you don't know what you're doing. God is present. He says to believers, I will never leave you. But we can convince ourselves that if I don't sense God or if I don't feel God, especially in a hard or a hurtful place, that God's not there. God says, I will never leave you. The writer says, if I take the wings of the morning and fly into the heavenly realms, he's there. If I go down to the lower parts of the earth and even descend into hell, behold, thou art there also. So God is everywhere. God is omniscient. And I say this in the face of scoffers and skeptics and the news and the media and all of that. There are kingdoms in conflict. And because you can't see it, that doesn't make it any less real. God is real. Say it with me. God is real. God is present. God loves you and me. God loves you and me. You don't even have to be a Bible scholar. They got it on the backstop at the baseball games. The people painted it on their face. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son that whoever believes in him, on him, hallelujah, shall have everlasting life. John says in the epistles, we know because of that, we know, not we think or we hope, we know that we have passed already from death to life. We don't wait to die to pass to eternal life. The Bible says we've passed and already made the transition from death to life. We got eternal life now. That's why when Christians die, if you go to a real Christian funeral that's biblical, we don't say they're dead, we say they're gone. We say they're asleep. Their bodies sleep, but they're as alive as they're going to be. They're in the presence of the Lord where there's fullness of joy. And either we believe our Bible or we don't. Hallelujah. He loves you and me. He loves you when you do it right. He loves you when you miss the mark. God, oh God, I wish I could, I wish I could come preach to every seat, every monitor that's on, every mobile device is on. Listen, God loves you. Even if you're a sinner, God loves you. The Bible says that while we were sinners, Christ died for us. Why? God is love. God is love. I come against a spirit of rejection and that filthy lie that the devil says that no matter what you did or didn't do, that God doesn't love you. You missed the mark. You were doing good. Something happened. God loves you. The devil is a liar. God loves you and has a plan for your life. God loves you and will be with you till the end. God loves you so you can recover. God loves you so you can be who you're supposed to be. Hallelujah. Some people been beat down with the hate demon. You're married to them, but they hate you. You don't, everybody's speaking off color to you. The neighborhood hates you. This race hates you. No, God loves you. God, be secure in God's love. You know, sometimes you struggle with that. Has anybody ever struggled with the love of God? How can God love me? I'm exposing the lie of the devil today. How can God love me when I know me? When I know, in other words, how about this? The stuff you hide from other people. But you know, right? God knows. And the devil knows. If no one else knows, you know. God knows, and the devil knows. And the devil is accusing you, see. And God tells the devil, shut up, see. The Bible says if we sin, we have an advocate with the Father. Now, we're not sinning habitually, just doing things that are wrong, but you know how it is. Life happens. We're not making no excuse for it. The Bible says to put it all under your feet and stand on the foundation, the rock that is Jesus Christ. So God doesn't love you. This isn't a meritocracy. God doesn't love you because you did good. And God doesn't love you more because you did better. God loves you, period. Case closed. In the story. Now, don't just hear me say that. I want you to begin to pray that. Father, thank you. You know, Father, thank you for your love. I mean, we're going to pray some intelligent, mature prayers. Thank you for your love. Thank you for being with me and staying with me when I missed it, when I was mad at you, when I didn't understand, when I shot my mouth off out of turn. God, thank you for your tremendous love for me. Somebody needs to pray that today before the sun goes down. God, I don't get it, but that preacher and your word declares that you love me with an everlasting love, and you promise that you will not desert me. Everybody I know that ran out on me, done left me, put me down, used me, abused me, and left me to die. But your word says that you love me, and I'm going to rest in that. I'm going to have confidence in that. That you love me no matter what. Next thing, he ordains that we should, can, and will pray. Luke chapter 11, when Jesus stopped praying, his disciples came unto him and said, Lord, teach us to pray. Now, here's where we get into a little bit. It says, Lord, teach us to pray, as John also taught his disciples. So that tells me that prayer, elements of prayer, is something that can be taught. They said, teach, it's interesting, King James, teach us to pray, not teach us how to pray. In other words, the inference is, I'm not going to teach you how to pray if you ain't going to pray. So he says, well, teach us to pray, and then we'll know how to pray. Right? So he ordains that we should. He says, men ought to always pray and never give up. Always pray, and that one translation says never cave in. So could there be a logical connection between our ability to stand strong and our willingness to pray? I mean, he kind of connects it. If you don't pray, you'll cave in. If you don't pray, you'll give up. If you don't pray, you'll be exasperated. And you know how it is. Sometimes we'll pull every lever except the one we're made for, and that's to pray. That's to call on the name of the Lord, right? And he also ordains that when we pray, that he will answer our prayers. Say, God will answer my prayers. All right, let's move on. Now, this one here is about, real quick, is about the reality of spiritual activity in places that you can't see, all right? So Daniel 9, 20 through 22. Now we finished up on Daniel, but this always captures me, whether we're in a fast or not. Now, I was speaking, praying, confessing my sins. Now, that's a big deal to me, because you can pray a perfectly aligned prayer, scholarly, erudite, and on point, even scripturally. And you know there's only a couple people in the scripture that the Bible doesn't give a negative report of. One of them is Joseph, right? Joseph was always good. One of them was Samuel. The Bible says no words ever fell from his mouth. One of them is Daniel. Daniel, there's never anything shady or slick said about him. And then, of course, Jesus Christ. And then crazy Paul says, I'm free from the blood of all men. I'm saying, how can that be when you was killing Christians when Jesus found you? But God wipes the slate clean. It's as if you never sinned. That's called justification. So you understand that in this life in Christ, you are justified, freely justified through the grace of God, through the blood of Jesus, just as if I never sinned. Justification, just as if I never sinned. That's powerful, man. So now the devil can't jump on your back about this sin thing. Amen. He says, I was confessing my sins and the sins of my people. You know why I think we have problems in church and problems in America, problems all over? Because folks won't confess their sins. They'll tell you what everybody else's sins is. We just got through with that, with the election and all that. Everybody doing this. I don't care what side you're on. I don't care what color. Everybody doing this. What about you, dog? You see what I mean? And when you see the great ones in the scripture, they always found a place to confess their sins. Look at the order. He didn't confess their sins first. He confessed his sins first. He says, if I regard iniquity in my heart, then the Lord will not hear me. It's not that God's deaf. He's like, I'm not going to honor that. I can't honor that. Right? He says, and then the man Gabriel reached me about the time of the evening offering, and then he informed me. Now listen, this is the result of prayer and dedication. He says, I'm going to show you things that come in the future. Just moving through Daniel chapter 10 now. Then he said, do not fear, Daniel. From the first day you set your heart to understand and to humble yourself before God, your words were heard. So even in this calamitous situation, Daniel doing the right process ensured that his words were heard on high. Verse 13, but the prince of the kingdom of Persia, not the king of Persia, but the spirit authority, the invisible demonic regent that was over Persia, withstood me 21 days. What he was saying is there's a war in the heavenlies. Now, this is real. I won't be able to get deep into it because I'm over time now. Please give me grace. He says the prince of Persia or the regent, like if you ever go to different cities, if you go into, I remember Margaret and I were courting or dating, whatever you call it, we would go back to the city that she had spent a lot of time in. As I got close to the city, I could feel atmospheric pressure. And it was the evil that was on the city. Now, no doubt, there are righteous people. Listen, we just went over it. There are righteous people in Babylon that refuse to become Babylonians. There are people in the city of brotherly love that do have brotherly love, but other people have made that one of the murder capitals of the nation because of the demonic forces that are above this city. You say, Pastor, why are you telling us all this? Because at the end of this, you and I must enter into warfare in heavenly realms. And the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. We don't go into heavens with AR-15s and this and that and the other. We go in heavenly realms with righteousness, peace, joy in the Holy Ghost. We go back praying in the Spirit, praying in tongues, interceding, running interference. We use the righteous heavenly weapons that God give us to put at bay. That's what happened here. I prayed. He says, we heard you the first day, but the one over Persia fought with what was supposed to happen. And then God, he said, he held me up 21 days. I called for Michael, the warrior angel. I called for him. And when he came, I was relieved. He did battle because he's a chief prince. He's a higher rank of angel to come do battle with this one that's over Persia. It freed me to come to you and deliver the word that got mailed out 21 days ago. Are you hearing me? So it's not time to do this cute church and presentations and all of that. Praise God for that. But there is a war going on. There's a war going on. You cannot be a non-combatant. You got to pick up your weapons. You got to get engaged. You might have to call a neighbor or a friend and say, man, let's do this together, tag team. Let's run a relay around the devil. Oh, I feel it happening. I feel something slicing through this atmosphere that you and I are going to have life and life more abundantly in 2021. Mask or no mask. Vaccine or no vaccine, virus or no virus, I'm believing for miracles. I'm believing for signs. I'm believing for wonders and mighty acts. Glory to God. Hallelujah. That angel said, now I've come to make you understand. Notice, some stuff you're not going to understand without a prayer life. I don't care how smart you are, how many degrees you hold, how many connections you got, how much money you have. Listen, there's only one way. It's Kneebone Valley. Hallelujah. I said it's Kneebone Valley. And it's going to be a joy, man. It's going to be a joy when we pray. I remember that night in Bishop's home, and he got the good. And so I was looking, following his exam. Next, man, we was up and down the floor. I'm telling you, hours passed. Hours passed, and you look at your watch and you say, man, I just got here 5 minutes ago. Hours passed because you are transported. You listen, you are transferred into another realm, and I'm telling you, you're doing battle in the spirit. You're not battling the devil. We got angels doing that. You're sending the word up. You arming them with ammunition of God's word. Hallelujah. I gotta go. 2 Kings. Here's another one. All these you should be reading on your own. 2 Kings chapter 6, verse 15 through 17. This is where the Syrians and the Israelites were about to do battle, right? Of the many, many times. And Elisha had a servant. When the servant of the man of God arose early and went out, there was an army surrounding the city with horses and chariots. And his servant said to him, alas, my master, what shall we do? What do we do? So he answered, the man of God answered, do not fear, for those who are with us are more than those that are with them. What? I say in the spirit, those that be with us are more than be with them. And Elisha prayed, Lord, I pray, open his eyes, that he might see. Then the Lord opened the eyes of the young man, and he saw, and behold, the mountains was full of horses and chariots of fire all around Elisha. See, what happened is God, he touched his sight. He could see into the supernatural realm. He could see into the reality of what God was doing. If we're judging it based on what we see, we need to pray, God, help me to see what I cannot see. There's more with us. You got angels in the outfield. You got people on your side. You got angelic beings that are running interference for you. Hallelujah. You're beloved and you're protected. You're cherished and you are of high value in the sight of God. So let this be the year we quit judging it by what we see or how we feel. I'm standing upon this word. God, I know, even if I cannot see, there's more with us. There's more with us. An innumerable, Hebrews says, an innumerable company of angels. Jesus said, I can call legions down right now, 72,000 angels right now. All I got to do is ask. Well, if Jesus could ask, then you can ask. God, send your angels. Send power from on high. Send remedy for my situation. Hallelujah. Yeah, faith in God and confidence in prayer. It's been a few years since I told this story, but I'm going to close. When we start talking like this and sharing with one another, I told you, you can sense discomfort in the atmosphere. Devils don't care how much you have church. In fact, they would hope that you have church, because oftentimes that's just something to satisfy our fancy and our feelings. But we're being nurtured up in the things of God. The Bible says, they that know their God. They that know their God. See, do you know who God is? Do you know that he's a very present help in the time of trouble? Do you know he's not a good luck God? Do you know he's not a last minute God? Do you know he's my every whim and I'm gonna order God around? Do you know he's sovereign? Do you know he's powerful? Do you know that he invested in you through Jesus Christ? Do you know that you are his creation? Do you know that he is jealous of you and that's why he will not let the devil have you? Do you know that he paid the highest price that could be paid for you in ransom? The devil held you hostage and sent God a ransom letter. And God said, I could beat you down right now, but then I'd be a thief like you were in the garden. So what's the price? God says, I'll pay the price. He created you. He bought you back. And when he comes back, he's going to take us with him when he comes. This is powerful, people. The devil got, God answered that prayer. We went in the army. And sometimes, and I'm not saying for somebody to pack up and move. I'm finishing this segment today. I'm not saying pack up and move. I know what happened in my life. I had to come to a place of desperation. Jesus asked Peter, do you love me? Do you love me more than these? Jesus is asking, do you love me more than this? I hear it. Do you love me more than that? Do you love me more than this, that, and do you love me more than your own opinion? Do you love me more than your past pain? Do you love me more than the thing you're holding on to as a safety net and as a place of security for you? Do you love me more than money, fame, or prestige? Do you love me more than any and everything else? We looked for a church so hard. We prayed. I prayed 6 months at least here in Delaware. Went in the army, and for me, God said, Genesis 12, we could maybe come back next week. He says, get away from your people. Get away. I don't mean we don't have people. He said, go into a country, go to a land, go to a place that I will show you. It's not so much a geographical place as it is a dimension. See, he could have did it here. But for me, he says, get out from your people and get away from your kindred, away from what's familiar, and I'm going to take you to a land that I will show you, and there I will cause you to be a blessing. What Coley was talking about today, not just, listen, be a blessing. Don't just give a blessing. Be one. Be a walking blessing. Are you hearing me? We got there and started going to this church. I thought it was a cult. Almost ran out the first day because it didn't sound Kojic, didn't sound Baptist. But the man of God was lacing it up like a new pair of shoes. I got ready to jump up, and the Holy Spirit said, stop. See, you ought to have an expectation that God will speak to you. Listen, forget all that. God invested in Jesus who gave his life for you to receive the Holy Spirit so you can hear from God. You can hear from God. Holy Spirit says, stop. In the middle of the service, he says, sit down. I said, he said, look around. He said, this is that. This is what you've been praying for back in Delaware. Remember the angel came to tell Daniel? He says, I come to make you understand what's going to happen in your future. We go on to fortune tellers and reading psychic tarot cards, releasing demons. God says, I got your future. I am your future. Why are you running to demons to get your godly purpose? Why are you coming up with good luck charms and pieces of jewelry and strands of hair and mixing the holy thing with the unholy thing? He goes, I am the Lord your God. I am the one that orders your steps, but you won't come to me about that. He said, you're walking in the future that you prayed for back in Delaware. I said, wow. He says, sit down, just like that. I sat back down, because I was paranoid, man. I was about to run out that joint. He says, this man of God, he says, you just recently were ordained. I said, yes, that's right. He said, you know the word of God. If the man of God gets off, you leave. But if he doesn't, that was my word right there, because some people, they want you to preach what they want you to preach. They think they know. See, that's a child. Child think they know what they need. Oftentimes, the child don't even know what they want, much less what they need. You as a parent assess what they need. My God shall supply all your needs. We come to God with a hit list. Want this, want that one. No, no. I'm going to supply your need according to my riches in glory through Christ Jesus. Found that church so excited Sunday morning. I said, Marcy, we were fussing all the way to church. Got back. We're going over the hill quiet. She says, what do you think? I said, I don't know what I think. I think I'm coming back Wednesday. We came back Wednesday. Same thing. Wednesday night, angelic voices around my head. Never had an encounter with angelic or the supernatural like that. Like millions of them. I could hear way in the back. So when someone tells you, though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels, they disavow tongues of angels. No, I'm in the scripture where it says tongues of angels. Though I speak with the tongues of men and angels, I didn't speak it. They were speaking it, right? So I knew what angelic tongues sound like, but I'd never been filled the Holy Spirit with the evidence of speaking in tongues. This is where I lose some of y'all on YouTube. Bye. I'm not saying you have to. Some do and some don't. I'm not saying you have to. Doesn't have anything to do with your salvation, but it has to do with my assignment. So I got happy and I started hearing this. And long about Thursday, Friday, Saturday, all this was around. I was doing all my daily duties. Saturday night comes. I'm going to sleep. Yay. We're going to join the church. Yay. I'm going to get what these people have. I don't know what they got, but I'm going to get. I know I'm saved. I know. I'm going to get what. Because it was on. I've been praying. Right? Saturday night, maybe past midnight. Some of y'all heard this story, it bears reiterating. I'm a heavy sleeper, right? Or at least I was then. Something wakes me up. Margo's the light sleep. Margo's sleep. I wake up, look down. Here's my hallway in this little apartment we lived in. Here comes this demonic creature down the hallway. I'm like the creature from the Black Lagoon. I mean, he's bent over like this. He's like 9 feet tall. His knuckles are almost dragging the ground. And he's big and hairy, and he's going down the hallway like this, coming my way. I wanted to tell you, because there's supernatural activity going on around you now. Are you fighting or are you forfeiting? Wallace, are you fighting or are you forfeiting your position, what God ordained for you to have, the authority and the victory and the dominion that you're supposed to walk in? Are you fighting? Are you forfeiting? And there are times when we get tired. This demon came down the road and down the hallway and he stood over my bed and he looked at me and I'm trying to touch Margo. I'm like, huh? I can't say nothing. I can't, she's 6 inches away and I cannot reach her. It's like a spell was cast. And then he transformed into a translucent blanket and went, and threw himself on top of me. And it was something between drowning in water and being in quicksand. I'm talking about I'm suffocating now. I'm suffocating. So it's a familiar demon. Some of you have had that experience. And as sure as you're born, I'm going down for the third time, and something the Holy Spirit says inside, will you speak out of your mouth what you've been hearing since Wednesday? And I just went, whatever it is. And the thing, as soon as it came out of my mouth, he jumped back. He was at the foot of my bed like this. And I just looked at him. He looked at me. He came from the floor up, from the ceiling down like a Rubik's Cube, revolved, and then shot through the wall. And I remember going, man, that's cool. And I drifted back off to sleep. I didn't realize I got filled with the Holy Spirit, but I'm going to church because I'm going to get the goods, whatever these goods is packing around here. Why am I saying that? Not to blow me up. When you make a decision and that decision is known, listen, when you speak it out of your mouth, please hear this. I know I'm over time, but sometime it's just going to be that way. I'm going to let you know. Because people live, they rise or fall at the strength of the message that God has given you to teach them. So I got filled with the Holy Spirit and still was looking forward to going and giving my life to the Lord or back. I didn't know what it was. I didn't care. When they gave the invitation, I mean, it was history. I'm telling you that because I want you to be aware of spiritual activity around your head, around your world, around your house. You've been marked by the devil as an adversary, an agitator, a person that's going to mess up the plan of darkness. But you've also been marked by the kingdom of God, Jesus Christ, and his name. It's written in you. That's when the demons came in the book of Acts and they said, Jesus, we know, Paul, we know, but you perpetrating. And they beat the snot right out their nose. So he knew who Jesus was, marked. He knew who Paul was, marked. He says, but who are you? You can't tell me because you don't know who you are. I'm here to tell you who you are. You're the beloved of God. You're the apple of his eye. You're the one that he never gives up on. You're the one, he has an everlasting covenant of love with you. Are you hearing me? So when we go to pray and as we go through these lessons in the next couple of weeks, I want you to have great confidence. Hallelujah. We're not going to be weak. We're not going to be unsteady. We're going to be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. We're going to fight with the weapons of our warfare, which are not carnal or fleshly or earthly, but mighty through God. For what? Pull down strongholds. Pull down stronghold. Listen, when you give, it's a weapon of war because Satan want to take that and dispense it somewhere else. When you give, when you tithe, I saw one time preaching from the pulpit, the people's envelopes leave their hands and it begin to decapitate devils in the spirit. You look and you may not receive that. I'm telling you, everything we do in obedience to Christ is a weapon of warfare that Satan cannot defeat. Who's down? Who's down? Who's ride or die today? Who's going to the battlefield? Who's going to Kneebone Valley? Who's going to pray like there's no tomorrow? Who's going to give God the glory? Who's going to shout the victory? Hallelujah. Thank you for your time. Let's pray. Father, thank you for this moment. Thank you for showing yourself to be real, even in this message and in this lesson. Thank you. I can see it, Lord. I can sense it for the spark that is lit in the lives of many people today. I believe that many may have been reaching the end of their road or the end of their rope, whichever. But because your word is fashioned, fixed, and ordained to go out and accomplish that which you please, that the kingdom of darkness has been thwarted and cannot, shall not, and will not make an advance against your people. I praise you for the young ones and the old ones and those that are in between, how that we would reference what you've done for us and the things that you freely give to us, and how that we can declare and claim and proclaim that because Jesus Christ is Lord of all, Satan and his kingdom is utterly defeated. Utterly defeated. And I praise you that as we speak your word and declare your word with boldness, that we will not do so with self-confidence, but we'll do so with the God kind of confidence that comes from knowing who you are and what you have said. Now, Father, in the name of Jesus, we join forces and faith together to stop, to intercept, to reverse and undo, to unshackle and to break every demonic system, every demonic tactic, every devilish purpose, every strategy, every implement, every amulet, everything the devil has thrown our way. God, we thank you. With the shield of faith, we cause it to fall harmless to the ground. We preserve our identity in you by the grace of God. I hear God saying to someone, come up, come up, come up, come up here. Don't be worried about coming up in society, coming up on your social media play. No, come up here, come up here, come here where I am. And let me show you. Yes, let me show you my plan and my intent. Deliver us from arrogance and pride, self-centeredness, competition, competing, insecurity, Lord, of every type and kind, wounds of hurt, distrust and despair, those that have laid their hands on us in an unsavory, unholy way. God, we thank you that we are free. Oh, glory, we are free. We are free from the devil's snare. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. Now, Father, as we enter into this study, I pray that you would guide our times, that you would cause the teacher, whether it's me or otherwise, to be on point, rightly dividing the word of truth, and that those who hear may be hearers, hearers of the word, appliers of the gospel, and one by one, and name by name, and moment by moment, hour by hour, we step up, we come up, and we receive what you have appropriated for us. And we give you thanks for that in Jesus' name. Now, quickly, if you're here and you say, I don't have a relationship with God, or I'm not sure, I'm just not sure. I'm aware of God, I love God, but I'm not sure. Listen, friend, make a conscious right now decision. Don't go away hoping. Go away knowing. Go away knowing that Jesus is in your life and all of your life is given to all of him. I want to pray for you while this anointing is present, while this weight of God, this kabod, this glory of God is in this moment. I want to pray for you if you're not sure about where you stand with God. And again, thank you, Lord. God says this generation is one that asks needless questions. And even if I could tell you the answer to your question, you'd only have another one. So he says, trust me for your salvation. Trust me for this moment. And we can talk about all the rest of it. Heads bowed, eyes closed. If you're here, just raise your hand and say, yes, Pastor, I want to be sure that I belong to God. I know I was baptized, I went to church, but I want to be sure. Is there anyone? Please raise your hand and hold it high. Thank you, sir. Anyone else before we close? Anyone else? This is the moment. Now is the time. And I believe, my brother, that from this day forward, your life will never be the same if you pursue Jesus the way Jesus pursued you. Your life will never be the same. Perhaps there's someone here and you say, Pastor Wallace, I'm interested in connecting with this church. I know we're virtual. The church isn't virtual. The church is real. But we can be here, there, and yonder because there's no distance in the spirit. But I want to connect. I want to congregate, affiliate. I want to connect with this church. Can you show me how? Yeah, we have information that we can give you. I see your hand already. God bless you, my sister. Is there anyone else? God is adding to a church. God is adding to his church. Thank you. I see your hand all the way in the back. It's a witness of heart. There's something that says, click it. This is it. You know. Anyone else? Anyone else? Yes, I see it. Yes, I see several more hands. God bless you. This is what God promised in 2021. The kingdom is advancing, and you're a part of that. Hallelujah. I don't know about today, but soon there's going to be a moment that we have when there will be manifested healing in body and in soul. There'll be times when those stubborn, some of you have stubborn issues. It just seems like it never ends. It's always that you, whatever it is, whether it's physical, financial, or whatever, you're going to see the glory of your God in the land of the living. Can you believe for it now? In advance, believe for it now. And before I pray, I just want to say, even in terms of finances, God's been good to us, even during the pandemic. But listen, don't think about it. Do it on the 30th of January, Financial Peace University. Think about that name, financial. That's where the issue is, peace. God gonna give you peace about it. And it's going to be at a university level. I'm not saying complex. It's going to be easy. The church has already paid the fee for everybody. So it's entirely free to you. So it's an opportunity that you take advantage of or one that you let slip by starting on January 30th. Can we pray now? Father, thank you for your presence. That's what we want. That's what we need, your presence. And we thank you for the conviction that's upon our heart as we sit and learn the teachings, the lessons, Lord. Even some of us who know it but may have forgotten elements or maybe have laid it to the side arbitrarily, we thank you that all of us together are coming back to you, a place of recognition and then a place of repentance, then a place of repair, then a place of restoration. We thank you for that in Jesus' name. And now for all those, Father, that raised their hand for this, that, or the other, I praise you that you grant unto them that petition. We already quoted the scripture. If it's according to your will, you hear us and then you give us the thing we ask for. We ask for salvation or the reclaiming of souls. We ask for the healing of bodies and we ask, Lord, for additions to your church. And because we do so with confidence in prayer and faith in God, we believe we receive it now in Jesus' name. Repeat after me, Father, I come to you now with the sole purpose of receiving Jesus as my Savior. I don't have to think. I don't have to hope. I don't have to wish. Today I know that Jesus died for me. Today I know that Jesus rose from me. Today I know that that same Jesus I receive into my heart by faith and all my days belong to you in Jesus' name. Amen, amen, and amen. God bless you. God bless you. Listen, you're dismissed. You're dismissed. But please, I know you want to hug and kiss. Please maintain your distance, head to the door, wave, do the virtual elbow, whatever you got to do. God bless you till we meet again.